From the 1930s through the 1960s, the Three Stooges played out their loony antics on screen to the delight of many millions and to the dismay of some parents. Today, they are as popular as ever through a resurgence on television, fan clubs, books, home videos, and theatrical showing. The Three Stooges Festival film program, exhibited by Midnight Shows Incorporated since 1974, continues to draw sellout crowds of adoring fans. Speaking of adoring fans, thousands were in attendance in 1983 when the Three Stooges were finally given their own star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame.
We'll never forget them. And 2 of my years with them was one of the highlights of my career in show business.
As we all know, that star may wear out someday with all the fans that we have throughout the world. But the fame and the popularity of the Stooges will live on as a legend forever.
Now there are even Stooge impersonation contests drawing all ages and genders. An army of devoted fans take never-ending delight in the well-executed bang on the head, the perfectly timed eye poke, and the ever-popular... And how did it all begin?
Once upon a time, there was a father and he had 3 boys, and they belonged in the reform school, and the 3 boys would not give their father a break. So the father got terribly mad. He got terribly mad. And he reached for a hammer. And he hit 1. Then he hit 2. Then he hit 3.
The Three Stooges Story. Mo Howard. Larry Fine. Howard, Jeff Howard, Joe Besser, Curly Joe Derita. The Three Stooges story began in the early 1920s with comedian Ted Healy.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ted Healy is next. I thank you. This is Ted Healy.
He was one of the highest paid performers in vaudeville, earning over $5,000 per week. Over the years, Healy had worked with various partners, including his first wife, Betty Brown, and even a dog. Frank Mitchell, who later worked with Healy, remembers.
He brought a dog on, and the dog did nothing. You know, and he threw the jokes at the dog all between them. And he was a terrific comedian. Of course, he was strictly taught, you know. He didn't do anything but talking. And he wore the crushed hat and things like that. He was a very funny man.
Soon, Healy had decided he needed to expand his act with the addition of some comic flunkies, known in vaudeville as Stooges.
Well, in 1921, I joined a boyhood friend of mine called Ted Healy. And he and I traveled together in vaudeville with his wife until 1923. When my older brother, Shemp, joined with us. It became 2 of us with Ted Healy. Then in 1925, we picked up Larry Fine in Chicago. He had been working with his wife and sister-in-law in a song and dance act. And they had a little something that separated them, and we found him working alone in a nightclub in Chicago, and he was doing a Russian dance with hi-hat and tails and playing a violin at the same time. I looked at Healy and Healy looked at me and said, "You're thinking what I'm thinking?" I said, "Yes." So Healy said, "Hey, you want to become one of the Stooges?"
He looked at me and dressed in a tuxedo and playing the violin. He said, "If we get this guy to throw away the violin, I think we got another whole
comic."
But
you had done a serious act.
Oh, yeah, I thought I was.
You weren't insulted?
No.
By the way, huh?
No, not with the money they offered me.
Healy and his newly formed trio of Stooges toured the vaudeville circus under various names, including Ted Healy and his Stooges, Ted Healy and his gang, and Ted Healy and his Southern Gentlemen. In 1929, the act appeared on Broadway in A Night in Venice. In 1930, the act made their first film appearance in the Fox production of Soup to Nuts, billed as Healy's Racketeers, Moe, Larry, and Shemp, were also joined by a fourth member, Freddie Sanborn. The Stooges' success in the film brought more movie offers, but Healy went behind their backs and told the studio they were under contract to him. Moe, Larry, and Shemp found out about Healy's ploy and left the act to form their own. The new act was called Howard, Fine, and Howard, and sometimes billed as the Three Lost Souls. Jack Walsh was hired to play Straight Man. The new act quickly took off as they toured the theater circuits. Healy attempted to stop the new team with legal actions. His persistent attack so worried Shemp he almost left the act, and only a pay raise kept him on board. Trying to counter the Stooges' success, Healy hired a new group of Stooges, Paul Mousie Garner, Dick Hackins, and Sammy Wolfe.
The routine that we did.
They opened the cage and let us out. What happens here? Come on.
Mousie, wait a minute. I said, let's do the routine we did in Azusa.
In Azusa?
Yeah.
I don't know why I feel loud.
Take it easy.
What's the matter?
You know, you're all right.
Watch him.
Watch him. Watch you.
What do you mean?
Watch him.
What's the matter?
Let me
hit you again. Once more.
That hurt.
Boy, he's got guts.
And he just pulled me out of the orchestra. And made a stooge out of me.
And Healy came in one day and he said to me, you want to work for me? I said, what is your name? You know, he said, Ted Healy. And he said, you'll be one of my stooges. He says, you look like just the right guy to be. I said, fine, Ted.
When I came in, I joined him in 1931. There was a show called Crazy Quilt with Ted Healy, Fanny Bryce, and Phil Baker. And Dick came in, and I walked in, and Dick knew very well. As I walked in, I didn't know Ted. I never knew that type of comedy, so he gave me a bang in the head, and I jumped on him, bit his ear, and grabbed his nose. He says, you're great. Get in line. You're hired.
But Healy's new act failed to catch on, and in 1932, with Moe acting as business manager for the Stooges, Healy reached a new agreement with his former sidekicks. But in 1932, Shemp decided to leave the act and pursue his own career. Moe eventually recruited his younger brother, Jerome, later known as Curly, for the act.
What happens, I'm singing, what happens? Right here is what we do all vaudeville act.
Are you vaudeville, is they?
Yeah, comedy, singing, dancing, and talking.
Okay, go ahead. Everything wants yourself.
Spread out. Right here, we're compelled to cut the act and go into another snappy gag.
Okay, kid, go ahead.
I walk down the street and meet the straight man.
That's Hatchethead.
Go ahead.
Hello, Moe.
Hello, Curly.
Wait a second. Wait a minute. What's his name?
That's Curly.
I thought it was Curly. I wasn't sure.
I was listening. Hello, Moe.
Hello, Curly.
What would you do if a girl kissed you?
I'd kiss her back.
Ah, suppose she was a big, tall girl.
In late 1932, Curly made his first film appearance in the Paramount short, Hollywood on Parade.
Oh, listen, I beg your pardon, but I know how you make people laugh.
You do?
Yes, I certainly.
How?
No, you're wrong, Lady. He's wrong, isn't he?
Yeah, this is the way. Take your time.
He's wrong. This is the way.
Do that again.
It's interesting to watch as Moe's character emerges as the leader of the Stooges and as he begins duplicating Healy's role.
Who started this thing here? Wait a minute.
Come on, yeah.
From the very beginning, physical mayhem was the Stooges' stock and trade. Wild slapstick violence delighted most everyone, but there were also critics.
What's the matter? You want to kill me?
In later years, Moe expressed his feelings on the matter.
So, for instance, now what do you do when you wrestle his nose here?
Well, look, actually...
Wrestle his nose. What do you mean wrestle?
Well, here's what he means. Now, ordinarily, someone might think there's an element of violence which is created in my expression, but actually my...
And
my,
his expression.
Now, hold your head still. My finger actually winds around loosely, but in the speed it's done with. Like this finger thing here, I never go near the eyes. It's way up here. But in the speed of it, it looks like it is in the way he takes it. Now, with Joe, I may grab him by the ear and look like I'm twisting it. His expression of pain and mine of viciousness builds up to the point, but actually, I wouldn't hurt this lad for anything.
No. You wouldn't hurt me. No.
I might give him a little smack like that.
Now, that didn't hurt.
No.
See, we're on the picnic, and he's having it.
Yeah, he's having all the fun demonstrating.
In 1933, MGM signed Healy and his Stooges to a movie contract to appear in film shorts and features. Their first film for the studio was Nursery Rhymes. The film was shot in an early two-strip Technicolor process. Screen billing was Ted Healy and Howard Fine and Howard with Bonnie Bunnell.
Thank you.
another bedtime story. I'll put the little darling to sleep with a song.
No, I'll put him to sleep with this. He's got a musical head.
Yeah, he's got a musical head. Let me try it.
No, no, that's not the place. That's not the place.
There it is.
No, that's not the place. Here. Mark that.
Mark.
Yeah, that's it.
If I gave you a dollar and your father gave you a dollar, how many dollars would you have?
$1.
I can see you don't know your arithmetic.
I can see you don't know my father. He don't know who you are. Little fly upon the track. The train came along and broke his back.
What do you want? Wait a second, boys. Boys, what do you want?
Don't go away until you tell us another bedtime story.
Once upon a time, there was a father and he had three boys. And they belong in the reform school. And the three boys would not give their father a break. So the father got terribly mad. He got terribly mad. And he reached for a hammer. And he hit one. Then he hit two. Then he hit three. And the children died. And he grabbed the fairy by the arm. And he headed for the beer joint. They lived happily ever after.
Much of the team's film work closely mirrored their stage act. And in their next MGM short, Beer and Pretzels, they appear as a vaudeville team.
Are you a lucky man? I suppose we're hired?
Hired? But what do you want?
What do we want? We're four waiters. And besides being waiters, we're four of the greatest entertainers that ever hit a cafe floor.
What about it?
Throw it right over your left shoulder this very minute.
What for?
Something is bound to happen.
Oh, nothing will happen here. I'll throw it over my shoulder, but I assure you, nothing will happen.
Somebody around.
Oh, you're throwing guys around. You know, if I didn't throw that salt over my shoulder, something might have happened.
In addition to MGM shorts, Healy and the Stooges also appeared in feature films like the 1933 MGM release, Dancing Lady. In the 1933 feature, Meet the Baron, Healy and his Stooges are featured along with Jimmy Durante.
You give me a bird, any bird, and I tell you where it comes from.
Oh. We give you a bird, and you can tell us where it comes from.
Yeah, but give me a good one.
Humiliating, that's what it is.
In March of 1934, Healy's contract with MGM was completed, and before he could sign any renewal with the studio, the Stooges decided it was time to go off on their own.
Well, let me tell you a thing or two. Right. If it hadn't been for you, we wouldn't be thrown out of these theaters. Always fooling around with the girls instead of rehearsing the act.
After the Stooges' departure, Healy continued to appear in films for Fox, MGM, and Warner Brothers. Healy died in 1937 at the age of 41. Some confusion surrounds his death. One report stated he died of a head injury sustained in a nightclub altercation, while another report said he died of a heart attack at home. Sadly, he died broke, with friends and co-workers having to contribute to pay for the funeral. Ted Healy's contribution to the Stooges' career cannot be underestimated. He set the formula that the Stooges would follow throughout the rest of their legendary career.
Any celebrities show up?
Yeah.
Sure.
What are you, autograph hounds?
Yeah.
Did you get any?
Yep, I got some.
Let me see.
I got a whole book full. Look at this. Will you look at that? Look at that. Look at that. Look at that.
Well, those stars write fast, don't they?
Yeah. Yeah.
You collecting autographs? No. Collecting photographs.
Well, look.
No, not of you, Crumbs.
Look. Look. This proves my point. A perfect specimen of the Neanderthal man.
What, that?
Yes. Oh, no. Look at the measurements. Look at that. Look at that.
What? That's the androgynous type. I can prove it. The androgynous cranium is always hollow. Now just listen.
No, 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 Professor, you're wrong. That is the skull of the Anthropedo.
No, no, that's more like the Anthropedia. Now, listen. Ah! The obvious Neanderthal type. Now, just note the difference. Neanderthal, Anthropedia, androgynous. Well, there you are.
Hey, fellas. See any prominent people? There's a lot of prominent people here.
Yeah. Neanderthal.
Who?
Androphobia.
What?
Androgynies.
What are you kidding? Hold it!
In 1934, the Stooges signed with Columbia to appear in a series of comedy shorts. This would begin a long, fabled career at the studio, more remarkable when you understand that it evolved into a series of one-year contract renewals negotiated with the legendary skinflint movie mogul Harry Cohen.
Harry Cohen signed us up at Columbia. He was the big boss then, you know. Very eccentric, but he felt we brought him luck. So he said, you boys will be here as long as I'm alive. And we were, and we started the shorts there for 24 years. The stories involved the sets that they had. In other words, any time they had a big picture, we knew what we were going to have to do. They had a set of a courtroom scene, we made courtroom scenes, and so on, all through our career. We never had an original set.
That was sure hot, Mo.
MGM was so rich, they did everything in a large manner, you know, where Columbia strove to save every nickel. You know, God help the guy that Harry Cohen caught lagging back on the job. Because he had a filthy mouth and a worse mind. And nobody seemed to like him, but we got along wonderful with him. He liked us.
The Stooges' first Columbia short was the 1934 release, Women Haters. Actress Marjorie White received top billing with the Stooges, billed as Jerry Howard, Larry Fine, and Mo Howard. Although Mo Howard originally received the last billing of the trio, it was clear he was not only the business leader of the act, but he had also replaced Healy as their on-screen leader.
Hey, what's the idea of spoiling the game?
I was for onesies.
Well, here's twosies.
Oh, oh!
He was for onesies? You get him to...
Here's fivesies.
Over the years, the Stooges have been fortunate to have very talented help in front of and behind the camera. Directors like Del Lord, Charlie Chase, Charles Lamont, and Ed Burns. Writers like Elwood Ullman and Felix Adler. Cameraman Henry Pulich and Al Keller. And producers like Hugh McCollum and especially Jules White, who also directed over 100 Three Stooges shorts. Aiding and abetting the Stooges on screen were Simona Bonafate, Christine McIntyre, Bud Jameson, and Vernon Dent.
Genuine import. Smell the ocean.
And it's 200% wool.
200%?
Yeah, these sheep led a double life.
Yes, sir.
And I'll get wrong
right in there.
Yeah. I don't want you.
Will you?
Hey,
I don't want a coat.
I don't want a coat.
I don't want a coat.
Oh, he don't want a coat.
What he wants is a pair of our slick slacks.
Why don't you tell me the man wants slacks? Get him slacks. Go ahead.
Vernon was a close friend and a very obliging man, and he did his best. He was an excellent actor, and he would not insist on sitting in conferences and polishing scripts for his own talents. He let you do that. He just did his level best with what you gave him to do.
Comedian and character actor Emil Sitka first became part of the Stooges screen troupe in 1947 and stayed with the Stooges right up until their final television and film projects.
What do you think you're doing?
We're getting ready to cut the kid's hair. What else?
Yep. You belong to the union?
Not yet, but we're gonna...
You can't cut this kid's hair till you join the union.
I loved it most when we were acting. And we knew that the fun was in creating laughs. And in those shorts, they squeezed in so many laughs within those 17, 18 minutes that was fun. I worked in a lot of feature pictures, so many of them, where it's just work. You produce your part, you do it, and so on. But here you made sparks fly.
Okay, partner, we're ready for the kickoff.
Join hands, you lovebirds.
Wait a minute. Who is this character?
She's the bride.
Oh, yeah? Not while I got my strength. Tell me, Poodle, didn't you propose to me?
Yes, but I'm with you.
Didn't you? Oh.
Yes, but you turned me down.
That was before I read the papers. Now I accept.
Wait a minute. What's going on here?
Hold hands, you lovebirds!
Hold hands, you lovebirds!
I say that so many times in here, out of desperation, so they finish wrecking my house.
Oh, Mr. Bevan, please, hurry!
Hold hands, you lovebirds!
What do you mean, how am I?
Congratulations, both of you!
Oh, thank you.
Yes,
we're married!
We made it. It's 6 o'clock and you're married.
What happened?
You're married, kid. Say something.
Help!
Edward Burns, who later became a director and writer for the Stooges, was a sound man at Columbia when the trio arrived.
My first exposure to the Stooges was on a short called The Woman Haters. It was a peculiar kind of a musical short. The Stooges weren't even starred. They merely appeared in it, and they appeared as individuals, not as a team. Very strange kind of a picture. We had a young man named Joe Henry, H-E-N-R-I-E, who was pretty close to being a genius in sound effects, and he loved the Stooges and expended enormous time and effort in getting the sound effects that I believe had a great deal to do with the success of the Stooge films. He would experiment endlessly with such things as musical saws, bass drums, and whenever he could cadge a sound crew, for instance, if he found a sound crew was going to finish early in the afternoon, he would get permission from the sound department to use them for the rest of the day, which many times the sound crew didn't exactly love being held over for more work, but he would roll drums, oil drums across the cement floor to give a certain kind of rumble and pluck violin strings and make these odd sound effects. And then in editing them in, he displayed great patience and great skill. Joe Henry, the Three Stooges owe a very great deal to an unsung hero, sound effects editor, and later head of the sound effects department at Columbia, Joe Henry.
Producer-director Jules White first met the Stooges at MGM. When he moved to Columbia in 1934 to start his own comedy department, he helped bring the Stooges over to the studio.
They tried anything that was possible to make the picture better. I want to make that as strong as I can. Moe was very helpful. Moe is an intelligent man compared to Curly and Larry, who were not quite as intelligent. Moe had good comedy sense. There's no gainsaying that.
Hey, where are the towels?
In the bottom drawer.
I got it. You sure look funny with a Buster Brown collar.
Hold that. Oh.
He was born in Brooklyn, New York in 1897. Moses Horwitz was the fourth eldest son of Jenny and Solomon Horwitz. Mo was bitten by the show business bug early, and he began skipping school to watch movies and shows. In 1909, he got a job running errands at the Vitagraph Film Studios. Later in the summer of that year, he met Ted Healy. The two boys became friends, spending a carefree summer at the beach. In 1913, Moe and his brother Shemp began a singing act together. Later, Moe took a job on Captain Billy Bryant's Showboat. For two summers, Moe was part of a stock company playing many different melodramatic roles. From that time on, Moe always considered himself a dramatic actor who went into comedy.
I played an old 70-year-old man when I was 16 years old, and played many of the old melodramas like The Old Homestead, East Lynn, and Human Hearts.
I don't remember these days, but I hear that they did exist once.
Yes, and I played with such people as Frank McHugh and Frank Morgan and Harding.
So this was quite a departure for you.
Yes, yes, I would say it was. This was a development over a period of years.
You enjoy this more, I take it? You stayed with it?
Financially, yes. But my old love is still prevalent as far as I'm concerned.
So really all these years of success have sort of been a saddened success to you in a way?
From the theatrical standpoint, I would say yes.
That's just interesting.
Just like Chaplin would like to play Hamlet.
In 1922, Moe met his wife Helen at the beach in Bensonhurst. They were married in 1925. Soon, facing the new responsibilities of a wife and a child, he dropped out of show business and tried his hand at various jobs, including real estate and retail sales. But the lure of the stage and a call from his old friend, Ted Healy, would put Moe back in show business for good.
I can't think when I'm hungry. Oh, a funny man. That's a matter with you.
What did I do?
What are you stalling around for? Then he smacks him on the head like that. Then he pokes his coconut into the letterpress. See, like that. Then he says, I'll squeeze the cider out of your Adam's apple. Then he gives him the works like this. Then he keeps turning and twisting. That, ladies and gentlemen, is...
Moe was the leader, and he kept that group together. He was the one that was the serious one, and he was the one that was the business man, you might say, of the group.
Well, gentlemen, I see you have really settled down to business.
We didn't do it, officer.
It's a lie.
We'll go quietly. The dishes! Now! The lug.
But don't let them upset you, boys. This club is going to be a great financial success.
Not only that, but we'll make some money, too. Yeah, then we can retire.
I managed the group, and there was anything came up. They would say, Moe will take care of it, which I did. And I never resented the fact that I did it. Even I did their income tax for 25 years.
No question about it. Moe was the one who kept them together. I used to have very nice chats with him whenever I had a little time between setups or whatever. And his conversation was always very interesting. We talked about many, many things. I found him to be a very interesting man, very much of a homebody. He was very wrapped up in his family.
More than any other member of the Stooges, Moe, seen here with his daughter Joan and his son Paul, worked hard at maximizing the group's income potential.
Oh, nice work, boys. We're in the chips, the moolah. Now we can pay skin and flint.
Moe's business sense helped ensure the long-term prosperity of the Stooges. He negotiated a special arrangement with Columbia boss Harry Cohen that allowed the Stooges to do personal appearances in between filming.
They gave us permission to go out on a personal appearance tour where they saved money and we made money because they gave us half salary while we were gone. So it was a good deal for them and a great deal for us. That was one of the sweetest deals in Hollywood.
100, 200, 300, 400, 500. 50. Oh, how'd that get here?
Merchandising became an important part of the team's overall business plan. In 1935, Pillsbury sponsored and distributed a Three Stooges toy movie projector. Also, a series of hand puppets in Moe, Larry, and Curly's likeness were sold. It was just the beginning of a long line of Stooge-related merchandise, which included comic books and children's records. As in all forms of show business, along with talent, you also need a little luck. The Stooges had both. In addition, each member's unique hairstyle gave each character a distinctive and memorable persona.
Well, mine started with curls many, many years ago, and as a youngster, I had to fight my way through on my way to school. And finally, I got discouraged and went to a friend's house, took his mother's scissors, and just wrapped these curls all around. When I looked in the mirror, I remembered later on exactly what I looked like.
Don't do it. Take the roast beef. It's rare, and
I want roast turkey.
Oh, but the roast beef is delicious. We're throwing in an extra potato today.
I don't like roast beef.
Oh, you don't, eh? Do you realize what a cow gives up? Do you both realize what a cow gives up just so you can have a little piece of roast beef?
I don't care what sacrifices a cow makes. Do I or don't I get roast turkey?
Now, let me put it to you another way. You have a kind face. A cow hasn't got a chance. All she lives for is just so you can have some roast beef.
Stop! You make me feel like a murderer.
Hey, waiter, come here.
What's the trouble, son?
I demand this insolent waiter be replaced.
But what did he do, sir?
Me too. I want roast turkey. He insists I have roast beef.
Oh, I'm terribly sorry.
Why, you dumb flat. What's the matter with our roast beef? Bring him roast beef.
Hold on! Present arm! Hold on! Right shoulder! Up! Bang! Hey! Right face!
This is my right face!
Oh, boy, are you ugly.
My mother likes me.
Some people like monkeys.
Who are you hitting?
Oh,
you're gone. Be quiet.
I order.
You order what?
I ought to be a little more careful.
Mo was the boss of the outfit. He was the brains. He was the man that you, if, for instance, I had any doubts about a routine, I'd give him a call and talk to him.
Grab your ear. Come on.
Generally, Mo would, Larry and Shemp or Curly were not much on reading scripts, but Mo would read the script and suggest changes, things that maybe would work better or wouldn't work. I'd cut and trim and add according to my conference with him, and that'd give us a final draft.
Have you got the ring?
Why, certainly. Certainly I got it. Oh!
It went in the piano. Get it. You see anything?
Yeah, wires.
Listen, you.
What?
You know, I think the piano's out of tune.
Go on.
I think I see it. Oh! Oh, I'm awful sorry.
So am I.
Oh! Oh, get me out of here. Get me out of here.
He's all tangled up with wires.
All right, we'll back him up and we'll break him out of here. All right, easy.
Shut up.
Hey, sit him down. I've got a new grip.
I'm in enough trouble as it is. Only this morning, I sent my patient from 212 out on the balcony for some sun. And I was terribly disappointed.
No sun.
No balcony.
Woo-hoo. Calling Dr. Mo, Dr. Larry, Dr. Curly Joe. Emergency in room 301.
We gotta go, Doctor.
Robert! Let's go.
Receive! You're always going first.
What's wrong?
It's broken.
Oh, emergency procedure.
Yeah.
Why? All right. Iron circulation. Quiet! You made me jump in nervous.
Now, isn't that better?
No! Idiot! It's not my leg! It's the TV set! That's broken! No, he tells us.
Quiet, I want to watch the show.
Mo and I had a relationship that others didn't even know. We used to visit each other's home. He'd visit my family. I'd go out with him on charity gatherings and so on and whatnot. But we also had deals made. When Mo made a deal with me, a handshake was as good as a contract. And he was the voice in all of their doings.
You know, we're lucky we got this job making pies for Mr. Hassenpfeffer. He said if the customers at his place like him, he'll give us a deal for more pie.
Boy.
Why don't you shut up and mind your own business?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, that's the way we're playing.
That's what you do for talking.
What's that for?
That's my friend.
Yeah, I'm his friend, and you put
ass for the friend.
All the pies ruined.
So they're all... Hey, wait a minute. No,
there's one that's in good shape.
Well, give me that, stupid. You're too clumsy.
No.
Oh,
no,
come
no,
on.
No,
give
no,
it to
no,
me.
No, who's my... Stumpkops, idiots! What are you doing?
Mr. Hasenpfeffer.
Very good. Make me 100. I like them.
Real pies were not used. They had several disadvantages. One, they'd spoil during a long, hot day's shooting. Two, they'd stain everything they came in contact with. And three, they wouldn't stand up to being thrown.
This is preposterous. What next?
Pies were generally thrown at short range. If you analyze one of the pie-throwing two-reelers, you'll find that almost all the hits were in extreme close-up. They're funnier, the closer the funnier, and the closer the more accurate the thrower was. Ray Hunt threw most of them. As I called him, our demon prop man. He was the prop man on all of the Columbia two-reelers for as far back as I can remember. He used to concoct them out of a mixture of shaving cream and other things.
You know, I was 35 years old before I knew a pie was made to eat.
Well, that's true. Soupy Sales would like to know that.
Moe dedicated his life to the Three Stooges. He did, however, appear without the Stooges in a few later films, including Spacemaster X-7 in 1958 and Dr. Death, Seeker of Souls in 1973. He also served as the associate producer of the 1959 Columbia release, Senior Prom. In the early 70s, Moe began lecturing at colleges all over the country, where thousands of eager fans jammed auditoriums to hear Moe tell anecdotes about the Stooges. He also made some solo television appearances, like this one in 1973. Here's a 76-year-old Moe Howard performing the classic burlesque routine, Slowly I Turn, also known as Niagara Falls.
And then I came face to face with a dirty rat that had ruined my life. It was in Niagara Falls.
Niagara Falls!
Slowly I turned, step by step, inch by inch. I poked his eye. I told his...
Wait a minute. Are you all right? You didn't hurt yourself, did you, pal?
Oh, I guess I'll be all right.
Oh. Boy, he's a nice guy, but when I say Niagara Falls, he's...
Niagara Falls! Slowly I come. Step by step. Inch by inch. I don't...
Later in the program, Moe got a little surprise from his wife, Helen.
She's in the audience today. Why don't you go over and give her a nice kiss, okay?
Bring her up?
Yeah, bring her up, sure. Moe Howard's wife, okay?
Later, Moe would write, "It was the first pie she had ever thrown. It was one of the high points of our long life together." Moe Howard passed away on May 4th, 1975. His life was a success in every way you can measure it. A legendary performer, astute businessman, and a beloved family leader. It's enough to give the word stooge a good name.
Will you throw that gum away? Look, I got rid of it. Wait a minute, hold still. I'll get it.
Hey, you're in a court, not in the woods, Tarzan. Cut it out. Come on.
Born Louis Feinberg on October 5th, 1902 in Philadelphia, Larry Fine will forever be remembered as the stooge in the middle. Although it can be said that Moe was the brains of the operation, equally true is that Larry was the glue that kept the team's identity together throughout all of its incarnations. In high school, Larry played the violin in the orchestra and became a versatile musician on many instruments.
Later, surprisingly, he also earned money as a lightweight boxer, competing in over 40 bouts. In 1921, Fine appeared in Gus Edwards' Newsboy Sextet, where he played the violin and told jokes. In 1922, Larry teamed with Loretta and Mabel Haney in an act called The Haney Sisters and Fine. Larry and Mabel were soon wed.
I did an act in vaudeville with my wife and her sister, straight singing and dancing, and I played the violin.
Lucky I did comedy. I was in a nightclub, and they gave a night for Ted Healy. When he came there, he had Shemp with him, and they liked the way I worked, and they asked me to join the show.
Healy's offer to Fine was for $90 a week and an extra $10 if he got rid of his fiddle. Larry accepted.
Then it was Shemp, Mo, and I, and that trio stood together with Ted Healy.
In 1929, the act, then known as Ted Healy and His Southern Gentlemen, began a successful run in the Broadway production of A Night in Venice. According to Larry, it was during this engagement he first appeared in his trademark hairstyle.
I had shampooed my hair in the theater, see, and somebody asked a question. I opened the door, and it was J.J. Schubert. We were in the show, and he said, "What's that?" My hair was all out, dry, and he said, "Leave it that way." And I did.
Good boy, you. Now sit there. Here you are, gentlemen. Hot dogs. When it comes to cooking them, catch me out.
Larry, often his ideas were irrelevant, but once in a while he'd come up with something that was so wild that it might turn out to be a gem. He was a bit flaky. I don't mean that disparagingly. Larry was a very nice guy and a trooper, but his ideas tended to be offbeat. But as I say, occasionally very good, very stimulating.
Stradivarius!
Larry enjoyed his success as a stooge. Unlike Mo, he was carefree and not very good managing his money. He also loved sports and gambling.
I say, Lord Larryington.
Oh, there you are, Sir Moeington. Kitty-o, pip-pip, and all that sort of rot. Old thing, old stuff, old fishmonger, old skunk bait.
You don't have to overdo it.
Well, we're trying to be elegant, ain't we?
Larry, happy-go-lucky guy that was very eager for the scene to finish so he could go off to the races. It was as if he was there because he had to be. And the minute it finished, all that he had on his mind was go to the races, to the fights, or the ball game. He always had guys around him that were talking about sports. I mean, hardly the script, ever. Mo was very serious. Shemp would listen. But Larry, what do I got to do? Let's finish it and go.
If you please, Doctor. Doctor! Doctor!
Oh!
Hey!
Oh! Oh! Look!
Larry was a whiner. Larry was a very nice, very sweet fellow. But he was a complainer. He was always bitching about something. And if he didn't like a scene, he would cry and he would complain and the others would tell him to shut up and do what he was told and eventually it would get done.
Come on. Give me a hand. Wait a minute. Hold it. What do you mean?
Although Larry may have gotten a reputation as a whiner, it never stopped him from being right in the middle of stooge mayhem, which always included some pretty physical exchanges with Mo.
We didn't pull any punches. I say we. Mo didn't pull any punches. When he hit, he hit. What you see is what we got.
Wise
guy, huh?
No, I ain't doing nothing.
Cut it out.
I know you're trying to jip me again.
Go ahead.
What do you mean, how am I? Get out. Let him alone.
Man.
Oh!
Oh!
Oh! There. Oh! Oh!
Sound effects could get you laughs.
Oh, yes. You could run a rough cut without sound, without...
Meaningless.
And it'd look awfully dead. And as soon as they... sound effects cutter put those funny noises in, the thing would come to life. Okay. Although the boys hit one another hard enough at times so that they were real hits and they made real noise.
The customer's always right, you get that?
Yeah.
Don't forget it.
What do you want?
I want Petty to Fogwall.
Well, I see the band can play it.
You guys know
better than... Hold this. Remember, the customer's always right. This is a high-class joint.
Do it.
A victim of circumstance.
And many a time, we didn't even use sound effects. Then one day, they had a scene where a fountain pen jumps out of a bowl of whipped cream and hits me right here.
Here is our invention.
Well, I'm dying to be the first one to see a fountain pen right under whipped cream.
Indeed, so am I. Now you take the fountain pen and place it in here. And put the paper in thusly. And pour the cream over all. Now turn the motor on to low.
Low.
Now would you care to make out your check for $50,000 now or later?
Well, yeah.
Well, after all the preparation, I said to Jules, I said, look, the hole that's holding the wire. You know, they shot on the wire. It's too big. It's going to hit me right in the skull. He said, oh, I wouldn't let nobody hurt you, Larry. So I see this fat man. I know he's going to do it fast. He did. And it went about that deep in my skull. I finished the scene, and I pulled the pen out. Ink and blood went all down my face. And I let him have it. Some choice words. What I didn't know was some teacher had a lot of school children on the set. I felt so terrible, you know, because we really love kids.
This is Larry's family, and this is Mrs. Fine. How long have you had that name?
Over 33 years.
That's a commentary on a side of Hollywood that we don't read about in the papers. All we read about are divorces. Does he bring home the crazy acts? Are you still a show business critic?
Yes, I am a critic.
You give him your opinion?
Yes, all the time.
What is it? Is he pretty good? Is he pretty funny?
After I get through with him, yes.
the power behind the throne. And next to you is your daughter.
My daughter.
Hi, Jess.
Hi, how are you?
Fine.
And she is married to quite a very talented announcer, Don Lemon, who is the host for the Three Stooges show in Los Angeles.
Although Larry was a loving husband and a devoted father, he resisted settling down, and for years the family lived at various hotels. He didn't buy his first house until the late 1940s. Larry was always at home with the Stooges. From the very beginning, his presence along with Moe's brought a sense of stability and continuity which made it possible for Shemp, Curly, Joe Besser, and finally Joe DiRita to be successfully brought into the act.
Shot course, lobbing by starboard. Port your porthole and poop poopy doop the poop deck.
Aye, aye, sir. I think I'm gonna be sick.
Fine sailor you are, on dry land yet. I ought to deck you one. Yeah? Hey, Mo, are you there? Did I get through to you? I guess I did.
On January 9th, 1970, Larry suffered a stroke which left him partially paralyzed. He would spend the last 5 years of his life at the motion picture country house, gamely trying to overcome the effects of the stroke. He also wrote a book called Stroke of Luck and found time to try to answer all of his fan mail.
40 or 50 letters a day, and I try to answer them all myself. I have no secretary. I'm all by myself, and I can write about 8 or 10 letters a day. You know, I do other things, you know, and sit around here. And it keeps piling up, and I'm wondering what the kids are thinking of. But I try to write one to every person. I don't want to leave anybody out. I appreciate what people are thinking of me after all these years. To me, it's a sort of a tribute.
One of Larry's last public appearances, he passed away on January 24th, 1975.
They'll have to give better service than this or this place will close.
I should say so. We've been sitting here more than half an hour.
Waiter, it's about time you got here. Do you realize we're waiting for you?
Yeah, of course.
Let's have something to eat.
Yeah, I don't mind if I do. Thank you.
What is the meaning of this?
You asked me to have something to eat.
Don't be ridiculous. John, this is so humiliating. Everybody's looking at us.
Will you take our order, or do I have to send for the manager?
All right. What do you have?
A menu.
A what?
A menu. I wanted to see what you had to eat.
I didn't eat yet.
A menu that you read from.
Oh, a menu that you read from. What do you have? Onion soup? Duck a la compre?
Jerome Lester Horwitz, later to be known as Curly Howard, was born on October 22nd, 1902, and was the younger brother of Moe and Shemp. From his youngest days, his brothers encouraged him to perform and always included him in the shows that they would put on in their family's home. Although young Jerome loved to entertain, he also loved sports, and especially, in later years, hanging out at the docks with a group of friends called the Bath Beach Gang. In 1929, Curly married a young woman whose identity is unknown. Curly's mother, Jenny, strongly objected to the union and forced Curly to get a divorce. Hoping to ease her son's pain, Jenny took Curly along on an extended European vacation. After Curly returned from Europe, he worked as a comedy conductor in Orville Knapp's band. He hated the job. Later, when he saw Moe and Shemp working with Ted Healy in A Night in Venice, he began hanging around backstage watching his brothers work. In 1932, after Shemp left the act, Moe suggested to Healy that Jerome take Shemp's place.
Healy says, great. But how is he going to wear his hair? So Curly says, okay, I'll be back here in 10 minutes. When he came back, he wore a cap, and when he took it off, he was as bald as a billiard ball. He went to the barber shop and had all his hair cut off. The funniest looking guy you ever saw.
Curly, hold it!
We called him Curly because he had no hair. Just like you'd call a 6 foot or a 7 foot fella, hey shorty, you know, we call him Curly.
Another winner!
So it was Curly, Larry, and I, with Ted Healy.
Stop! You fool! Are you trying to kill this man? Why don't you mind your own business?
Shut up! I'll do the talking. I'm the boss, ain't I?
Well, you're not getting any place. You better try a little chiseling.
Oh, he's great at chiseling.
We left Healy at MGM in April of 1934, and June of 34, Columbia Pictures signed us up to the longest contract that anyone ever had at any studio.
Please try to be a little more quiet in the court.
By 1935, Curly was firmly ensconced as a member of the Stooges, and he was quickly becoming a favorite of kids who loved his childlike antics.
Now, what do you have to stipend the court for? Get gone.
Curly, who was affectionately called Babe, liked to have a good time.
Yeah, I like Curly particularly because he was not a complainer, because he would go along with almost anything when even on the roughest stuff with the eye pokes and all this stuff and the slaps on the head and all that routine. I don't remember him ever being unhappy about that type of thing. He would go along with most anything and not complain, and he was nice to be around.
And poor Curly was a genius in my way. A real nut. You had to be a little crazy to stay in show business, you know that.
Well, Larry, you take 9 and 10. Mo, 11 and 12. Curly, 14 and 15. I go to you.
He used to go out with George Raft, you know, years ago, and they won every prize everywhere. Very good dancer. Very light on his feet.
Isn't the music divine? What's the idea? Who are you?
I'm the fella you asked to dance.
How dare you?
Oh, superstitious, eh?
By the mid-30s, Curly was feeling some pressure to settle down. After all, both Mo and Larry were happily married. In 1937, Curly became engaged to Elaine Ackerman, and the couple were married later that year. In 1938, Elaine gave birth to their first child, Marilyn.
Well, actually, the first time I saw Curly, I was about 13, 14 years old. And I went downtown, and it was set up like a little bit of a vaudeville act. And I thought they were funny, but I really didn't get into what they were all about. I think now, as an adult, I enjoy them a lot more.
We go to nightclubs, and of course, he was a cut-up when we were out in public. And he'd take spoons and bend them and play them to music. He was very talented musically.
Not only did Curly love having a good time, he also found himself constantly attracted to other women.
Oh, you're such a doll.
His second marriage ended in divorce after just 3 years.
Oh, let me out of this madhouse!
During the following years, Curly led a wild life of parties and women, and in the process, his weight and health seemed to suffer.
Now let me see your little heads get busy. The pipes are there.
Oh, it's the pipes that need handling. Shucks.
The only thing that I ever knew about Babe was that he always liked to talk about women. He was he liked that. And Curly, I beg your pardon. He was commonly known as Curly, or his name was Babe.
Oh brother.
They called him Babe.
Oh brother.
Oh, yeah, I always had a feeling that sometimes in the morning he would look as if he hadn't had much sleep. And he would kind of hint that he had been out having a hell of a good time someplace. But once the camera rolled and he would start in, he would be a little bleary at the beginning. But once he started, then he was his old self again. And he was a very lovable character.
I find your horseplay most annoying.
All right, break it up.
Come in closer, boys. While I explain. Now you heard what the boys said.
There was no denying the appeal of the Stooges' on-screen physical antics, especially for kids. Not to be outdone by their films, the Stooges capitalized on their popularity by including a generous amount of slapping and poking during their many live stage appearances. It came as no surprise that many imitators quickly tried to cash in on the Stooges' popularity, including none other than Mousie Garner, Dick Hackins, and Sammy Wolf, the former Ted Healy Stooges. After a brief attempt at unsuccessfully calling themselves the Three Stooges, they soon changed their names to the Gentlemaniacs.
What are you, wise guys? Pay me the $50,000 and I'll foreclose this mortgage, you mouse.
I won't pay it.
Don't get excited answering the mortgage.
Pay me the $50,000 or I'll foreclose.
I won't pay it.
For goodness sake, pay him the money.
Unfortunately, they, as most other imitators, merely copied the violence, which was only a small part of the real Stooges' appeal. In 1945, Curly married for the third time, and like his first two marriages, this one also ended in divorce, lasting just 9 months. Both his private and his professional life seemed to be in turmoil.
The diary said, walked on the set just in time to see Curly fold up. Well, that undoubtedly, no one knew it at the time, but that undoubtedly was the first of his strokes. I guess everyone assumed it was just a fainting spell. Nevertheless, by the time I directed my first picture with him, Curly was not his old self. His reactions were slow, and he couldn't recall his lines very well. And in my first picture, first one I directed, The Bird in the Head, I had prepared to the hilt, as you can well imagine, directing my first film, and had it all planned out. Well, when the actor can't carry through on a scene, you have to improvise, which was an ordeal for me. It was not the Curly that I had known in my years as a sound man when I worked on the Stooge films. But with Moe's help, we got through the picture. On microphonies, strangely enough, Curly had revived and did very, very well. I think it gave everyone in the short subject department the hope that he would recover.
In a rare departure from Columbia, Curly and the Stooges appeared in the monogram picture Swing Parade of 1946. This became Curly's last feature film.
Yes, Larry. What are you looking for?
A watch.
A watch?
Yeah, it went down the drainpipe.
That was Moose's watch. He'll murder us.
You better go and get it quick.
I can't.
Oh, yes, you can, because you're going right down that pipe after it. Come on.
Wait a minute.
Come on, get up here. Don't. Pardon me, boys.
Hello. Who is this?
This is Curly.
Where are you?
Down the cellar.
Did you find the watch?
What watch?
See this?
What? Oh!
Larry.
Yeah?
Third dimension. Larry, how you doing?
I ain't found it yet.
Well, don't come up until you do find it.
It's awful dark down here. Keep your shirt on. I can't see a thing.
You better hurry up before Moose comes back.
If you think you can do any better, get down there yourself.
Quiet, I can't hear a thing. Look in the little dark corners.
What?
Why, did you find my watch? It went down the drain. You put it down the drain pipe? Well, you get down and get it or I'll skin you alive. Come on.
Easy, Moose, easy.
Find it yet, Moose. A little leak started in the cellar. We had to fix that first. But listen, Moose is on his way down here and he's plenty sore. Curly, did you find it?
No!
Hey, Larry! It ain't in here!
What are you guys doing in there? I gotta...
His next to last film, Monkey Businessman, it was an ordeal for everyone. We had to shoot his lines one line at a time, shoot and cut, cut to somebody else, come back to him. He could remember only one line at a time. But strangely, on the very last one I did with him, Three Little Pirates, Curly was himself again and did very, very well. But of course, on the very next film he did, with Jules White as director, he passed out on the set, and that was obviously the stroke that disabled him, prevented him from doing any more work.
That film was Half-Wit's Holiday, Curly's last official Three Stooges film.
And then I got a script for somebody called The Three Stooges. When I appeared on the set, I saw a lot of workmen around, the three short ones, and chubby sort of. It turns out that they were the Three Stooges. I got introduced to them. Curly called me sir. Very dignified, you know, and very respectful. That was my first start with the Three Stooges, and of course, it was Curly's last.
Shep Howard returned to the Stooges, replacing the ailing Curly.
The transition was smoothed over by the fact that we'd had many conferences, and Elwood was in on them, and there was no attempt made to have Shemp do Curly stuff. It was Shemp doing his Shemp thing.
While recuperating from his stroke, Curly met and married Valerie Newman in July of 1947. On May 7th, 1948, Valerie gave birth to Jane, Curly's second daughter. Except for a cameo role in the 1947 Three Stooges release, Hold That Lion, and another cameo role that was cut from the 1949 release, Malice in the Palace, Curly never appeared on film again. Curly died on January 7th, 1952.
I know that when Curly died, there was a great tragedy for all of us. First place, Curly was an extremely funny man. Extremely funny. I think he had a sort of a Chaplin-esque way of working.
No objections.
No objections.
No objections.
Curly, the original Curly. We lost him, we lost something, I'll admit it. However, we got Shemp, who was one of the originals.
By the early 1920s, Shemp and Moe had joined Ted Healy. Born Samuel Horwitz in 1895, he was 2 years older than Moe. Like Moe, he caught the acting bug early, and by his teens, he was performing in vaudeville. In 1925, Shemp married Gertrude Frank, and they gave birth to a son, Mort, in 1927. Over the years, Shemp was always suspicious of Healy and his business practices, and in 1932, Shemp decided to leave the act and pursue his own career.
Shemp got the opportunity to play Nobby, the manager of Joe Palooka in a film series, and he didn't want to go, figuring that he'd disrupt the combination, and I said, go ahead, this is your opportunity, we'll get the kid brother, Curly.
In 1933, Shemp began appearing in Vitaphone movie shorts. In all, he would make over 30 films for the studio, including Smoked Hams and Serves You Right. He also worked at other studios, and in 1934, Shemp appeared with Burt Lahr in Henry the Ache. In the 1934 release, Knife of the Party, we see an obvious attempt to duplicate Shemp's early success with Ted Healy. Notice the billing of Shemp Howard and his Stooges.
Wait,
a minute, fellas. That's my new saw.
What do you want? What is this?
What do I want?
Yeah.
How do you like that? Say, why don't you leave him alone?
Oh, stop. Oh. Don't tell me what if.
You see that?
Yeah.
I'm a little too quick here, ain't I?
In 1938, Shemp moved over to Columbia, where he appeared in many shorts, including some directed by Jules White and Ed Burns. Of course, by now, Columbia was also the home of the Three Stooges, who were starring in films like Mutts to You and Disorder in the Court.
No, no. Take the stand.
You're in the court, not in Clancy's pool room. Sit down.
I'm a victim of circumstance.
Over the years, Shemp worked at other studios, and in 1940, Shemp began appearing in feature films released by Universal, including Hell's a Poppin' with Olsen and Johnson, and he also made feature films with Abbott and Costello, like In the Navy. At this time, Shemp was a very busy man.
Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. Anyone else but me. No, no, no. Don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me.
In 1942, Shemp was featured with the Andrews Sisters in Private Buckaroo.
I just got word from a guy who heard from the guy next door to me. The girl he met just loves to pet and a fit you to a T. So don't go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me. With anyone else but her. No, 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 not a single soul but me. No, 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 don't you go walking down Lover's Lane with anyone else but me. Not till you see me. Not until you see me marching home. Home, 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 sweet home.
Monogram Pictures tried to capitalize on the popularity of the Three Stooges, so they teamed Shemp with Maxie Rosenblum and Billy Gilbert in three films. The first was the 1944 release, Three of a Kind.
Well, brother, your troubles are over.
Yeah? Which one are you to cook?
Him. Him. Well, you see, we're both cooks, but Shemp, oh, he's a whiz, that guy.
Yeah? Can you make lamb stew?
Oh, brother, he makes lamb stew and the customers eat it. They think it's turkey.
Oh, that's bad. Huh? Because here, lamb stew has got to taste like lamb stew. Oh, it ain't lamb stew.
When Curly became ill in 1946, it was Moe who decided to bring Shemp back to the Stooges. And in 1947, Shemp appeared in his first Three Stooges film, Fright Night, directed by Ed Burns.
I love Shemp's work, and, Stooge fans who put down Shemp because they love Curly, it's not fair. They, Shemp never attempted to be Curly, and Curly was one of a kind.
I'm blinded.
Yeah! Oh, no! Oh!
Want a piece of pie?
Oh, Larry!
That guy's dreaming again. Oh. Why don't you... Hey, Larry! He's been smoking in bed again. Get the water in the act.
Put me out! I'll put
you
up!
That's what you...
Oh! Oh! Oh!
Hey, you...
He was completely different, and yet in his own way, he was very good. There's no question about it. He had his own brand of comedy that was excellent, but there was no... I think it would be very wrong to compare Shemp with anyone else.
Shemp was the funniest of them all. He was the type that didn't tell you what he's going to do, just like Curly. But when the cameras turned on, he put in a lot of funny stuff, especially in his own that weren't in the script. And that guy, when we'd finish a scene, would continue on it. And he'd have you laughing until you had a cut and plead for stopping him, you know? He was the most funny off and on screen. When he was not in the picture, he'd be telling jokes and having you laughing. When he'd be performing, he'd ad-lib so many little things in there that the other Stooges knew where to let him do so, you know.
Easy, easy, easy. Get off your foot. Look at what I got here.
What's that?
One of those. Yeah, and wait a minute. It leads around under my arm, then up here around the neck.
That's your...
Get your hand out of here.
Oh, all right.
Easy, easy.
All right.
of mine. Oh, so we can pull
easy. All right. Easy. All right.
Now, wait a minute. Can you dial from there?
No, can you?
Yeah.
Oh.
Now, look. We ain't getting no place fast. Let's get at this thing right the right way. You know how to get this on.
All right, wait a minute. All right.
It started with the book, didn't it?
Mo, where's your hat?
How you doing?
Get your hand out of my face.
That ain't my hand, that's your hand.
All right, you asked for it.
Ow!
In Brideless Groom, there was a scene that required Christine McIntyre to slap Shemp around. She had grounds for doing that. She thought he had got some hugs and kisses by false pretenses. She mistook him for her cousin Basil, I think it was. Well, Christine was a real lady, which to me added a dimension to the Roughneck Stooges. She had a degree in music from a music college in Chicago, and it was not in her nature to slap anyone around. But when it came to do the scene, she held back, and Shemp, after several poor takes, begged her to cut loose and really do it right. And she did.
Your cousin Basil? Well, then who is...
I was just...
How dare you pretend to be my cousin Basil? I'll teach you a thing or two. You're wolf! Don't you dare strike me! Taking advantage of a poor, weak, helpless woman! You horrible person, you!
Many people don't approve of violence, but it can be funny. You can't dispute that. And that was, to my mind, beautiful violence, if you'll excuse the expression.
Well, Shemp was probably the kindest, funniest, sweetest man I've ever known. I used to go over there, gosh, seems like maybe once a month or maybe more even, and I remember getting a silver dollar every time I went to visit, and just a very giving, you know, sweet man.
That's what I call easy pickings.
Are you telling me?
Well, may see you later, chump. Don't stay in the office too long.
Dirty crook. You mind if we breathe?
Well, that did it. We're flat broke.
Got a dime for coffee?
Say, I had some airmail stamps.
Well, what do you know?
I know you're trying to chip me again.
Mo, I wasn't trying to jip you. I thought I had a couple of... Mo.
Yeah?
You took my money, didn't you?
Yeah, sure.
My pocket was empty, wasn't it?
Sure.
Well, what's this?
Hey, there's something funny going on around here.
Shem's here. It's him.
Oh, I ain't afraid of ghosts. Stand aside. I'll prove it. Keep your hands in your pocket. Shemp, if you're around here, give me a smash on the chin and convince me. Oh!
Oh, I'm convinced.
In 1949, Shemp made one departure from the Stooges when he appeared with Abbott and Costello in Africa Screams.
And he's going to protect me?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Gunner, show them how you can shoot the Winchester.
You missed the lion. I raised the gun to my shoulder. Look through the peep sight, mate.
In 1949, the Stooges filmed a half-hour television pilot, which was produced by Phil Berle, Milton Berle's brother. They hoped it would be the beginning of a weekly series.
We never made a television series. We wanted to.
When Columbia Pictures got wind of the project, they threatened them with a lawsuit, claiming they were restricted from appearing in a series that would compete with their movies. Thankfully, the pilot, called Jerks of All Trades, was completed and still survives.
You were never cut out to be a painter, brother.
Oh, that's just a means to an end.
No.
We rehearsed this thing, partly in my place, partly in Moe's place, somewhere else, and so on.
Hey, stupid!
with Shemp as the third stooge. It was very well rehearsed down to the commercial times. And it went well, and we filmed it at ABC Studios.
Will you please stop that whole thing? Move, guys. What are you doing here? Bum, bum, where you standing up there?
Let him go. It's your fault.
No, you don't. Come out. Bum.
Say, you're not mad at us?
Of course not.
Well, it was a pleasure to do your painting and paper hanging.
And it's a pleasure to do yours.
Goodbye.
Goodbye. Goodbye.
The Stooges' contract with Columbia did not prohibit them from making guest appearances on television shows, which they often did, like this one from a 1950 Ed Wynn show.
Here, boy, take this rug and beat it. I can't wait for a vice president to talk. Oh, prepare for the double zinger.
No, not the double zinger.
Thank you, then.
Put your fingers out like that. Now hold your arms out that way. On your mark, get set.
In 1951, the Stooges appeared in the United Artists feature Gold Raiders, directed by Ed Burns. It was shot in just 5 days and at the amazingly low cost of $50,000.
Who do you think you're talking to, partner? I'm the roughest, toughest, rootinest, shootinest hombre that ever come out of Arizona. Reach! Reach now! I give up!
There's a jawbreaker for every lawbreaker as hard-punching, fast-shooting George O'Brien raises riot with the Raiders. But the real roughhouse begins when he's backed up by those hard-boiled eggheads, the Three Stooges. See the West at its wildest and the Stooges at their woolliest in this walloping wow of a Western.
Tomorrow morning, I'm bringing a shipment of gold ore into Red Mesa. I expect a bunch of hijackers to try and take it away from me.
They're crazy. They'll never get it away from you.
That's right, because I won't have it.
He won't have it, clever?
No, but you will.
We will.
What?
In 1952, the Stooges guest starred on The Frank Sinatra Show.
You gotta do this right. Elegance, poise. You see, hold back a little bit. Now, do you understand?
Yes, sir.
That's it. Now, here we go, answer the door.
There we go.
Oh, almost had 7 years of bad luck. Here?
Oh, still. I said stand still.
Oh, oh, oh. Hey, I cut off my head. My head is off. Oh, there I am. And as pretty as a picture.
Yeah, but Nate, get gone.
Moving into the early 50s, the team continued to have great success at the film box office and also with live appearances. But on November 23rd, 1955, tragedy struck again when Shemp unexpectedly died. Moe remembered.
Shemp passed away in 1955 in 30 seconds. He went to the horse races in the afternoon, went to the prize fights at night, and on the way back with his friends, he laid his head on his friend's shoulder and he was gone, just like that.
The sudden loss of Shemp required some quick thinking by Moe.
Shemp is not. Oh, Shemp is. Oh.
Is this what you want, sir?
Thank you. Champ! There seems to be some mix-up regarding your eligibility to enter these portals.
Well, I'll be on my way. Get me a pitchfork and a Red Union suit and I'll go.
Wait. I'll give you one chance. Go back to Earth and reform Moe and Larry, and you can come back here for good.
Gee, thanks. I'll reform that Moe and Larry if it kills me. Hey, that doesn't make sense. I'm already dead.
Actually, what Moe really had Columbia do for several of the shorts was to use stock footage of Shemp from previous films. For instance, in the 1956 release, Rompus in a Harem, Scenes with Shemp from the 1949 Malice in the Palace were used. In addition, actor Joe Palma, seen here on the left, was used as a stand-in for Shemp. Moe and Larry then considered going it alone and calling themselves the Two Stooges. An outraged Columbia boss, Harry Cohen, quickly stopped the idea, demanding, "I'm paying for three Stooges, not two." So it was time to find a third Stooge, and the choice was Joe Besser. Joe Besser was born in 1907, and from his youngest days was hooked on a career in show business. His first job was with famed magician Thurston. Later, he worked the vaudeville circuits, teaming with such acts as Olson and Johnson. In 1940, Besser toured in a comedy act with straight man Jimmy Little. A film contract with Columbia Pictures soon followed. He appeared in films like Hey Rookie and Dizzy Yardbird. He also made many radio and television appearances. Ironically, Besser had appeared with Shemp in the 1949 Abbott and Costello feature, Africa Scream.
Not me, him! I'll go get help. Oh, you're such a nuisance.
In the early 1950s, Besser played the role of Stinky in the Abbott and Costello television show. Joe Besser signed on with the Stooges in 1956.
Well, I was still working at Columbia Pictures, and Shemp, one of his brothers, died. And they asked me if I would like to jump in and finish out the contract for them, for the Three Stooges.
Joe Besser? Well, of course, now he was an established comedian before he came in to be a Stooge, you know. And I admired his style, of course, before he joined the Stooges. And when he joined the Stooges, I got to know him a little bit. The thing is, he still continued his, you know, favorite way. Oh, squash you! And I didn't know how to fit in with the Stooges because they didn't bang him around as much as they did, you know, Curly and even Shemp. But he had his own way.
His first film appearance with the Stooges was in Hoops and Goofs. In 1957, he made his only known live appearance with the Stooges at the Paramount Theater in Los Angeles. Besser appeared in 16 Three Stooges Columbia shorts. Also, Columbia released a feature-length program made up of Three Stooges shorts featuring Besser. After the last Columbia short was completed, the Stooges' contract with the studio was dropped. The Stooges had a powerful ally in studio boss Harry Cohen, but it all came to an end with Sappy Bullfighters.
Harry Cohen, the minute he died, out we went too. But even Whately was buried, and while the services were going on, the guy said, so we knew we were through.
After 24 years, in 1957, Columbia did not renew the Stooges' contract option. By the late 1950s, television had definitely made an impact on the film industry. Shrinking audiences and rising costs had forced all the major studios to stop making short subjects. Besser was asked to go on the road with the team, but his wife suffered a heart attack, and he not only bowed out of the tour, but was forced to leave the act entirely to care for his ailing wife. Joe appeared in many films and TV shows after leaving the Stooges. He was also a regular on Joey Bishop's 1960s television series. Joe died on March 1st, 1988. During 1958, Moe and Larry decided it wasn't time to pack it in just yet, and the search was on again for a new third Stooge.
A talking automobile.
You are expected. Enter. I am waiting.
I am Larry. I am Moe. And I am Curly Joe.
Their choice was another show business veteran, Joe DeRita. Born Joseph Wardell in 1909, and unlike all previous Stooges, he came from a show business family, first performing with his mother and sister as a dancer.
My family's in Baltimore, my mother and sisters. I was raised in show business. I have my mother and father in it. I've been in it since I was 7 and a half. And I was done everything, vaudeville, nightclubs, tent shows, tent medicine shows.
DeRita later became the star of his own two-reel comedy series and also appeared in features like the 1946 release People Are Funny. DeRita first appeared as a Stooge during a 1958 nightclub engagement, but it wasn't until he cut his hair and took the nickname of Curly Joe that things really began to click for the team. A 1958 package of Three Stooges shorts sold to television drew strong ratings and new fans. Reportedly, Columbia made $12 million from the sale of the Stooges films to television, but the Stooges didn't make a dime because only films made after 1960 were eligible for residual payments to the actors. But all the new success brought an unexpected consequence. Complaints from various groups about violence in the Stooge films began to surface, and television stations began to edit the films any way they saw fit.
We won't even notice them.
Who won't? You can't say that about us! Who are you again?
Let him alone. I'll give you two.
What TV helped take away, TV was now giving back.
They are stupid.
The reinvigorated Stooges, now with Joe DiRita, began touring. A turning point came when the Stooges played the Holiday House in Pittsburgh.
It was after our engagement at the Holiday House in Pittsburgh, where we went for 1 week, and the man held us 3 weeks into the 1959, then Steve Allen picked us up.
Among the great comedy names of our time are three men who for many years convulsed the motion picture and vaudeville audiences of this country with their hilarious knock-em-about style of comedy. It took the medium of television and the perceptive minds of today's youngsters to rediscover their greatness. So here from three record-breaking weeks at the Holiday House in Pittsburgh are, let's welcome them, the Three Stooges!
We're back again, it's great to say hello.
Hello, hello, hello,
back again, it's great to say hello.
Hello, 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 back again.
Hello,
hello, hello, back again.
What's the matter with you?
That's all. I've taken all I'm going to take off of you.
Curly Joe moved effortlessly into his role with the Stooges. Because of his physical similarity to Curly Howard, he was often compared with him. Mo took advantage of the resemblance by bringing back some old Curly routines, like the Maharaja sketch, seen here in the 1941 feature Time Out for Rhythm with Curly Howard, and then reprised with Curly Joe on the 1959 Steve Allen Show.
The Rajah says that at this time he will toss the razor-edged daggers at random.
That's good. Get him up here. Hey, Randy. Come on, let's go to the cage. Wait a minute. Wait a minute. You don't think I let that nearsighted owl throw knives at me, do you?
What do you mean, nearsighted owl? He can see better than you can, and I can prove it.
Well, you better prove it.
Serious. Rajah! What is that? A half a dollar!
The trio would also make personal appearances with many of the local TV hosts of their films, like this one with Officer Joe Bolton from WPIX in New York.
They wanted me to go on the road with them because they became popular all over again because they started playing them on television. And unfortunately, I couldn't go with them because my darling wife took sick. So they had to get somebody else, and they got Joe DiRita and made a lot of money. That's the only thing that I was sorry I couldn't have done it. I'd have been able to retire now.
I think they reached their peak or thereabouts, because in 58, they hit like a lightning in the television, I mean. They made personal appearances. They worked in arenas and these great big stadiums. They really got big money. They didn't get big money in the films. They got good money, but I'm talking about real big money.
The Stooges continued to play sold-out engagements with fees as high as $25,000 for one day. Columbia realized the Stooges were hot all over again and signed them, and in 1959 released Have Rocket, Will Travel.
Yes, it's the Three Stooges who are making history, all right, but laugh history.
Doc! Take that down, quick.
In 1960, the producer of Have Rocket Will Travel and Columbia released Stop, Look, and Laugh, a compilation of old Stooges shorts hosted by Paul Winchell. It was a blatant effort to bypass the Stooges, who wanted a larger share of the profits for another new movie. In 1961, 20th Century Fox released Snow White and the Three Stooges.
Hiya, folks. We're on the stage of Snow White and the Three Stooges being chased by the palace guards of the Wicked Queen.
Never mind the talking. Grab the battle axe.
Hurry, it's 100 men to 3. Now it's 100 to 1. Will the Stooges escape the palace guards? Will the princess be rescued? To find out, see Snow White and the Three Stooges. Right?
Right.
In 1962, Columbia released The Three Stooges Meet Hercules. Budgeted at under $500,000, the film was an enormous hit, even outgrossing Half Rocket Will Travel.
Hold it, men. He's gonna spring a trap door.
Yeah, watch it.
You think we're stupid or something?
Yeah!
The only time we had to stop production was in The Three Stooges Meet Hercules. I fell out of the carriage and Curly Joe hit me right here. 280 pounds. I thought Chewy crushed my chest. They took me to the Cedars of Lebanon, where fortunately they found out I didn't have a crushed chest. Maybe I'm stronger than I thought I was.
Later in 1962, the Stooges blasted off at the box office again with the Columbia release, Three Stooges in Orbit.
Take the machine at once. Destroy the Earth as you leave.
Destroy the Earth?
How we fix the gas?
Well, the arrow is pointing halfway. I don't know whether it's half empty or half full.
Columbia kept the Stooge films coming, and the next was the 1963 release, The Three Stooges Go Around the World in a Daze.
I and the boys and I, are going to this Canadian National Exhibition. And it's wonderful for me because it takes me back many years when I was in Canada on another engagement. The wine, the ale, the beer, the scotch, I was there a month, they told me.
In August of 1963, the Stooges smashed a 76-year attendance record when 85,000 fans came to see them at the Canadian National Exposition. That same year, the Stooges made a cameo appearance in United Artists' release, It's a Mad, 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 Mad World. Also in 1963, they were featured in the Warners' release of Four for Texas, starring Frank Sinatra and Dean Martin.
When I say go, you all point to the right. Go!
In 1965, Columbia released what would be their last feature film, The Outlaws Is Coming. The story involves the Stooges helping Kenneth Cabot, played by Adam West, and Annie Oakley, played by Nancy Kovac, battle a ruthless band of the West's most feared Batman. Actually, all the outlaws were played by the host of Stooges TV programs from all around the country, who were flown into Hollywood to be in the film. Not only were the TV hosts given parts in the film, they were also treated to some very good food served up at a barbecue hosted by the Stooges and producer Norman Maurer. In 1965, the Stooges began production of a television series called The New Three Stooges. Each program consisted of brand new live action, wraparounds, and animated segments.
Follow me. Fall in. Follow that tube.
Rolling, rolling, rolling.
All the live segments were filmed in just over 6 weeks.
Good morning, folks. At your service.
May I take care of your windshield? That's it, Peppa.
It's stuck.
Can't you do anything like...
Joe DiRita is supposed to give me a rough time. Sort of insulting, and my part calls for me to slap his face. And then as he gets more insulting, I do it again. And then he challenges me to do it again, and I do it again. So each time should be a little harder.
You know, you've just struck one of the toughest men from the state of Texas. Tell him, Tex.
Yeah, look here. You got it. Let's not carry it too far, huh?
Oh, just a minute, sir. You have just insulted a true Texan. Do you know what could happen to you for this in the state of Texas? Go ahead, tell him, Tex.
Just a moment.
Bang! Terrific take. He's flawed. Ed Burns laughs, and they all, huh? It's very good. But Joe, you know, he's going to seek vendetta on me.
I'm from Milwaukee.
Believe it or not, I couldn't believe it. Bo told me later, said, he's mad. What the hell about it? What, the slap? The slap. It was good, perfect, funny. The kind I would take. But no, he's got a scene in the follows that he's going to hit me with a cake in the face.
Let me tell you about this banana cream.
And Mo warns me, says he's going to really let you have it. What, is he going to break my nose or something? So I'm ready. And all, well, he comes at me with his big cake, and I could tell. So I kind of give with it, and I knew it had a lot of force behind it. That he, and I pretended like I was, oh, geez, my head, oh, gee, oh, God, you know. And he was going around smug like that, and, you know, walked out.
As the 1960s drew to a close, the Stooges continued to make various television appearances. But changing taste and their advancing age slowed down the team's schedule.
Step right up, young man. Tell you what we're going to do. Arthritis your trouble? Got the cure right here. The electronic calisthenic vaporizer cures arthritis with paramagnetic force at a special price of only $1.43.
No? Well, here's what you're looking for. My own secret formula, Pedal Pills. And it'll only cost you $7.40.
Oh, double talk? Sure. But believe it or not, gadgets and phony drugs like these rob arthritis sufferers of over $250 million every year. And we want to ask you to support the Arthritis and Rheumatism Foundation and help find a cure. That's it, and we thank you.
In 1968, the Stooges appeared in a short film promoting United States savings bonds called Star Spangled Salesman.
Hey, fellas, I wonder if you'd be interested in signing up for the payroll savings plan.
The payroll savings plan?
Yeah, well, I know what you're going to say. You're going to say you can't afford it, right?
I wasn't going to say that.
Were you?
No, were you?
Why would I say a thing like that?
Everybody out! Run out! Get busy!
Don't worry, they're wearing Dickies work clothes, made with soil release finish so they come clean with one washing, fortified with Fortrell. If Dickies can make the Three Stooges look good, imagine how great you'll look.
In 1969, the Stooges began production for another new TV series called Kook's Tour. The self-financed pilot featured the team as retired Stooges who would travel around the country in a kind of comic travelogue. But on January 9th, 1970, Larry Fine suffered a stroke which forced an abrupt end to production. Over the years, Moe promised longtime friend Emil Sitka that one day he might become a Stooge.
But I never took it seriously until one day he comes to me, and he used to often come to where I work, take me out to lunch and say, Emil, I must come. You're going to be a Stooge. I said, no, you're kidding me. You mean seriously? Seriously. The contracts are drawn up. And sure enough, it was for the Jet Fest to be shot in Palm Springs. I am the Stooge. It's official. Now we're waiting for Mo. Mo calls and says they're shooting. They want us on a set next week, but we're going to postpone it for a week. Time goes, another week, he postpones. Producer calls me, there's something wrong with Mo. Mo's wife calls me, the Stooges is dead. Meaning Mo died. Come to the funeral, Emil.
Speaking of surreal Stooges, Joe Derita also appeared in the group called the New Three Stooges. Joe hired former Healy Stooges Mousie Garner and Frank Mitchell for the act.
And we went up to Joe Derita's house, sat down and talked it over, and we started rehearsing. Before you know it, some dates came in, and we took pictures and everything, and we opened a place outside of Boston. The next day, we went down to the rehearsal at the ground there of the park, you know, and there was a tremendous crowd waiting for us. They were suspicious about the new Three Stooges, who they are, what they look like and everything. But the way we were signing autographs, they had us tangled up with the other three, you know what I mean? But they knew we weren't the three that made the pictures and all, but we went with Curly Joe. And it was tremendous, and we signed a lot of autographs, and we felt good. It made us feel good to go out to do a show.
Joe Derita passed away on March 3rd, 1993. And with his passing, the Three Stooges were gone, but far from forgotten. The joy they gave the world will be with us forever.
One of my grandsons made mention of the fact when I asked him why he had shifted from Popeye to watching the Three Stooges. He said, well, we all like the Stooges better. And I said, why? He said, well, you do some of the things that Popeye does. You look like cartoons. But sometime we could get to shake hands with you.
Well, all of us would like to shake hands with the Three Stooges, including each and every one of the six unique individuals who contributed to the success of this legendary group. They gave us something very rare, pure, uninhibited silliness. It's no small gift. For in our time, when serious matters crowd our daily lives and comedy relief can border on the nasty or vulgar, the Stooges are still here with a wacky abandon that can delight kids and charm work-weary adults. Simple foolishness with no hidden meaning. Inspired nonsense that's guaranteed to bring a smile to anyone with a heart young enough to let the Stooges in.
Thank you.